Welcome to Reason for Truth. I'm your host, Stevie Garofalo. Listen, is loving your enemies the better way? Well, let's look at Matthew 5:38-42. Listen, looking at the Sermon on the Mount by Jesus, he gives us the answer. But first, I want to look at famous comedian Rodney Dangerfield. He once said, hey, listen, do to others before they do you. Making light of Luke 22:39, which actually says, love your neighbor as yourself. Very different things. Today we're going to examine the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 38-42. And here Jesus tells us not only to treat others as we want to be treated ourselves, but really to take it a step further, saying that, listen, we are to love our enemies and not just those who we get along with or maybe that we like or that are kind of like us. So how exactly do we love our enemies? That's a bit different story. You know, it's one thing to love ourselves. It's another thing to love others that are like us. And it's really a very different thing to love our enemies. Welcome to Reason for Truth, where the truth comes first and reasons come last, but where we're always and constantly learning, because when we stop learning, well, we stop teaching, or at least stop teaching well. Today's truth is that Jesus came to give us a better way, and that when possible, we might go the extra mile for the other person. Really overlooking an offense, maintaining the peace, turning the other cheek. These are things Jesus told us we want to do. Jesus tells us that the righteous need not necessarily claim their rights in every circumstance and every situation. Jesus did not negate the need or the use of the lex talionis as provided in the Old Testament, the law, right? But by a better way, we talk about that shortly. We're not claiming our right, in other words, to enact retribution in every situation. Today, we're going to again examine Matthew 5:38-42 in an effort to discern what exactly Jesus meant by telling us to turn the other cheek and love our enemies. My gosh, that's not an easy task. I just mentioned lex talionis, or the law of retaliation, found in the Old Testament, which is commonly referred to in modern times as an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Speaks to raw justice without grace and patience. Jesus comes to give us a better way. See, does the Bible tell us to embrace the law of non-resistance and lay down all defenses? Well, that's a good question. Is Jesus telling us to become a doormat in order to love our enemies? That's another good question. Let's be clear that the lex talionis, or the law of retaliation in biblical times, provided a good way to end feuds, much the same way it does today through our legal system. Jesus is just saying, we need to work things out as believers, especially amongst ourselves, before we get to that point. Jesus is not speaking to the law as administered by the government, by the way. Different situation. He's speaking to us as individuals, as the Sermon on the Mount does, and as a better way for us as individual Christians to maintain the peace and give a stunning testimony of our faith as to our faith in Jesus Christ by doing something crazy, by forfeiting our assumed right or our rights for retribution and turning the other cheek. You don't see that much today. You just turn on the media and going the extra mile as well and loving your enemies. You see, in a nutshell, Jesus provides us with a new way, another way to accomplish the same thing that the law does, but in a very different and a much better way, right? At the end of the day, we're designed to have justice and have peace. Now, in the non-democratic Middle East culture, you have a lot of tribal retaliation, have that in many cultures, very different than the West here in the United States, based on the rule of law. And the law of tribal retaliation is the most commonly accepted and practiced method of administering justice, especially in the Middle East, different tribes. A devout Muslim man and his son from Palestine, they lived here in North Carolina. I used to see them daily at the gym, about 5 days a week. We used to have a lot of dialogue on God and truth and ethics. And we talked about a visit that his son had made to Palestine. And he was very proud to tell the story about a disagreement broke out in the town they were in, and which led to a physical fight. And when the fight escalated, my friend's son, who was really beginning to fight, became outnumbered. This in turn drew his cousins to get into the fight and other family members. And what happens? The other side, their family members got into it. And after a while, he got a brawl. And after a real lengthy brawl, they dispersed. As a result, in accordance with tradition of that part of Palestine, his dad told me, how they resolved it, they went and they got the most senior elders from each tribe, each family, representing that family, sat down with each other and came up with the best thing they could for a peaceful resolution. Even if it wasn't resolved, at least it was a peaceful resolution to the point that they would stop fighting and the feud would subside. You see, Western culture and the lex talionis, or the law of retaliation, was to be administered by the governing authorities, not by individuals. So when we look on TV, we see anarchy. That's kind of what, in part, what we're looking at. And God provided us government authority as a way to create peace throughout the nation. But if we look at what Jesus is telling us here in Matthew, you don't even need to get to the point to get the government involved in the first place. So instead of fighting it out, turning the other cheek. Quite opposite, as you can see, Christianity is opposite of any other worldview, any other religion, in that Jesus died on the cross. He loved us first, right? We didn't love him first. He loved us while we crucified him as the human race. Now, the lex talionis was given to Moses by God in an effort to protect the innocent and to assure that a standard of law would come, right? Justice is blind. It would really minimize this whole idea of retaliation on this common day-to-day level, as my friend was talking about. They don't have that. So does this mean that Jesus told us in Matthew 5 regarding loving your neighbors? Is that at odds with or a conflict with the Old Testament law? That's the bigger question. I'm certainly glad that we don't have this tribal fighting, but I guess if that's what it had to come down to, then we would just fight over every little thing, right? And as believers, it really destroys our testimony to the non-believing world and really to new believers and to all believers when we fight, and we fight when at least one, if not both parties, are really out of line with the truth, doing the right thing, and with Scripture. I'm not talking about justifying what you think is the truth. I'm talking about the truth. That's tougher. So today I want to show you that Matthew 5 does not violate the lex talionis, but rather complements it much in the same way that Jesus came to abolish the lex talionis, or the law, right? Meaning the law. He came to fulfill it. See, Jesus made it clear less than 20 verses prior in Matthew 5:17 when he said, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets." He said this just previous. He goes on to say, "I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." Matthew 5:17. See, in today's passage, Jesus is clear that he provides us a better way by solving personal conflicts when possible, which in turn generates an incredible reflection of God's grace, his mercy, his love, and a strong witness for Christ. So while the rights of the innocent are always to be protected, by the way, protected by the law, as believers in Jesus Christ, we ought not always claim our rights in all situations. It's kind of dying to self, right? Proverbs 19:11 makes it clear in saying this, "A person's wisdom makes them patient. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense." Proverbs 19:11. We as Christians ought to be characterized by humility and selflessness, not selfishness. This means that if possible, that we voluntarily go the extra mile to maintain the peace. If possible, when wronged, if possible, it's better not to strike back. It's better not to demand repayment or refuse to comply, right? When possible. The truth is found in Romans 12, where the scripture tells us, listen, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. It's Romans 12:18. That includes the world. Remember the key words there, when possible. There are times we just can't do that. And we'll talk about that further in this episode. By the way, this is part one. You want to make sure you subscribe so you don't miss anything. But part two, we're going to finish the second half of this. As Christians, by the way, we seem to want justice for others, but we just love and we feel it's a right of ours to have mercy and grace bestowed upon ourselves, right? Sadly, it's common, all too commonplace in Christian culture to take advantage of other Christians in the name of turning the other cheek. That's not what Jesus is saying here. Jesus tells us that instead of retaliating in all circumstances, that when possible, listen, we do the opposite and commit our case to the Lord, who will one day set all things in its proper order. So lastly, when possible. Remember, when possible also speaks to instances such as where it's necessary to use self-defense, one's life, threaten of bodily harm, death, or major legal possible infractions that might cause massive corporate harm, you know, legal harm or otherwise. In other cases, we're called to the biblical model of addressing the issue with the individual, right? That's really where if we're dealing with another believer, we're called to go to the individual first, then we go to the church, right? We go to the pastor and so on. So listen, if the person doesn't repent and there's infraction there, then you may need to take it to the law. That's the way it goes. I'm not talking about criminal law. That's different. I'm talking about civil law here. Criminal law, if someone's, you know, broken into a house or, listen, that can't be resolved, or this person has created a violent a violation of the law in terms of assault, rape, or murder, or something like that, physical, in that case, I think the person has to answer to the law. In most cases, you're not going to resolve that, okay? At the end of the day, if you're acting biblically, we should never have to go to court to begin with, But it does happen. If acting unbiblically, the law is there to sort out, sadly enough, what we can't do on our own, what we don't want to do on our own. So Jesus here gives us a new model, a better way to live our lives day by day, where, listen, daily conflict abounds. Listen, if you deny that, you're lying to yourself. You're lying, and I'm lying to myself. We have conflict every day in our lives, just the way it is in a sinful world. It's not going to change till we go home to be with Jesus. But to prove how the solution works or will help transform them, I would like to share with you four different kind of times in my life where Jesus commanded to turn the other cheek. And it really became an issue whereby I had to make a tough decision in each one of these cases. And I'm going to share them with you to kind of put some feet on this lesson. For story number one, I remember as a new believer in Jesus Christ, I was helping a young missionary put her support mailers together back before computers were popular. I just happened to have a computer. You know, I think it was like a 286, maybe 386. Can't remember. It's a beefy little machine with 40 megabyte hard drive. All right. Telling you how long ago that was, right? Well, anyways, I happened to have that. She didn't. So I said, hey, I'll be happy to help you put your support mailers in. I never knew anything about missionaries growing up, but I wanted to use this new technology that I had to help her. And I figured that was the one way that the body of Christ can help one another. And I happened to have that tool through my business in Washington, D.C. So it was we were printing out our mailing labels. We got to speaking about the concepts of turning the other cheek. Now, she was a member of a denomination which believed in the concept of turning the other cheek literally and at all cost in all circumstances. See, they read Matthew 5:38-42 as so literal that you're never too able to defend yourself or your family to the point of unjust death. So I asked her this question. I said, what if someone comes to your house, man? Your dad's eating dinner, your mom's eating dinner, all your brothers and sisters. And someone comes in and begins to assault you guys, maybe murdering a couple of you. Your dad has either a bat or an axe or whatever, a stone, a gun. And he's able to actually stop the person from creating harm or death or assault. What happens then? I just said, I just got to ask the question. I mean, extreme, right? But it's the truth. And what she said kind of shocked me a little bit. She said emphatically that they just have to sit there and get slaughtered. And I firmly but respectfully disagreed with her in that that violates scripture as well as really state laws, national laws, laws of the United States of America. But carnally speaking, it certainly violated my Italian heritage, by the way, which reflects the biblical settings having occurred in Rome, Italy, just saying, and the surrounding region. So the law of the United States of America provides the right and really the obligation to defend one's life, and in many cases, the life of others, when life itself is threatened unjustly, and we have the ability to stop a threat. Now we're talking about the law of omission and commission. The law of commission is when you commit a crime knowingly. The law of omission is when you fail to do the right thing, when you could have saved a life, but you fail to. Kind of an ethical, moral question. So if you see someone's drowning, right, and you have the ability to throw them a rope, but you just go, man, I'm late for lunch, I don't like the person, or the person is not the same color or religion as me, I'm going to let them drown, or I just don't feel like dealing with the person. Well, in any case, you've just created a crime, both a moral violation in the eyes of God, and that you caused the death that you could have prevented. And secondly, the law is going to hold you accountable from a legal end, certainly from a liable civil perspective if you get caught and charged. So if you're able to stop an injustice but fail to do so, it can be an omission of the law or justice. See, we often see crime as a commission or proactive action of one's part to harm another, but it also can be an omission or a failure to do something to preserve life. You could read and make the scripture say anything you want, but in proper context, you got to understand what it really means. Big difference there. One interpretation, many applications. Always keep that in mind. And we got to make sure that we understand correctly what this lex talionis is really saying, what Jesus is saying in relation or in, you know, as a better way of the law of retaliation. Instead of just saying in every case, I had to give you an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, and let's go roll and let's fight and say, hey, what's a better way to resolve this? Biblical principles. This is true in marriage, by the way, not just from a violent perspective. I'm just talking just resolving conflict, right? If we all did this, I think we could cut our marital strife by quite a large percentage. So in this passage, by the way, Jesus provides us a new and better way of how to respond when wronged. Now, let's look at case study two, story two. Over 20 years ago, before my wife and I had children, we went out to celebrate one of our very early wedding anniversaries. And upon entering our town, we came very close to the home. We were on a couple acres. We drove up down this side street. It was a dead end, and I did not see this guy till literally last minute. Right up on him, hit the brakes. This guy is sitting there. He's wearing all black leathers, sitting Indian style, driving a black motorcycle parked catty corner. He certainly didn't belong there. I really didn't see him till I rolled right up on him. And I really didn't have the opportunity to call the police. I mean, I just looked at him and said, hey, everything okay? He's just out of place. Could do something for you? See, we unknowingly stepped into what turned out to be a drug deal. Well, make a long story short, the vehicle with the drug buyers who had left returned back to visit us at our home a couple minutes later. Everything rolled out pretty quickly, and they rolled right in their driveway. My wife and I, still in the SUV, sitting talking. We didn't even know that they were coming until we were about to exit our SUV. And out of nowhere, the four young men drove down the street into our driveway at a very high rate of speed. First young man begins to jump out of the Jeep while it's still rolling. Man, these guys are young. They could do that stuff, right? And I had to make a split decision. And what ran through my head was four young men, me and my wife, very outnumbered. And I had a decision to make, right? So what did I do? I stepped out of the vehicle, told my wife to stay in the vehicle, drew down with my Glock. I know that's controversial, but that's what I did. In a split second before the other three men had a chance to exit the vehicle, I let them know very pointedly and very loudly in my voice, "You have now become a threat to my life and that of my wife. Freeze, stop, do not move, and nobody else get out of the Jeep." And that was, I said that command repeatedly. And the first man, he kept coming despite my repeated commands, but he finally stopped by God's grace. And only about 1 to 2 seconds before I had made the decision in my mind that I would have to use force to stop the threat. Listen, I am so thankful I never had to do that. I often think about that event, and I give praise to God, because to use deadly force, even in the event of self-defense, that's something that nobody really wants to do. And everybody who does that is going to have to live with that their entire life from a mental, spiritual, and legal perspective. Listen, what goes through my head now is that man was somebody's son. It's all I could think about even then. We had a brief discussion. I talked with these gentlemen, and we established a very good understanding that all is good. Didn't want to make a big deal about it. They made up some wild story that was not true at all. I was able to verify that later. And what did I do? I called the police immediately. And matter of fact, I only called the police not only that evening, but I called the next day. It was so shaking for my wife and I that we wanted to get understanding what happened and how do we prevent this or help prevent this in the future. But that's not the thing you want to do. But I called the police immediately, and we had a conversation. The sheriff came over and he said this. He said, "Listen, they're not coming back." I was happy with that assessment. But listen, what would have happened had I not confronted the threat? That might have been a whole lot worse than what happened, right? A whole lot worse. And it was just me and my wife versus four men that were all larger than both of us put together. That would have been an unfair fight. And I had to protect the life of my wife. If it meant the cost of my own, albeit. So I hesitate to tell that story because it's not designed to be a political statement or statement about weapons or guns. But listen, if I had a baseball bat or I had a rock or a sword, the principle will remain the same. And that's what I want to communicate to you now. Now listen, when Jesus sent his disciples out, by the way, the second missionary journey in Luke 22:35-38, Dr. Luke is very detailed, tells us this. And he, Jesus, said to them, "When I sent you out without a money bag and a traveler's bag and sandals, you did not lack anything, did you?" And they said, "Nothing." And he said to them, "But now the one who has the money bag must take it, and likewise a traveler's bag. And the one who does not have a sword must sell his cloak and buy one." It's pretty strong. "For I tell you that what is written must be fulfilled in me." And he, Jesus, was counted with the criminals, for indeed, what is written about me is being fulfilled. So they said, "Lord, behold, here are two swords." And Jesus said to them, "Listen, it's adequate." In other words, two swords is more than enough. Luke 22:35-38. What's the point, Steve? Well, Jesus is saying two important things here. First, by stating that he was counted among the criminals and that two swords were adequate enough, Jesus is limiting the use of the sword to self-defense, not to be used as a means to spread the Christian faith. We don't do that. That is wrong. Remember that guns were not, by the way, yet discovered. There's no such thing as a gun. during the lifetime of Jesus, so the sword was equivalent to a gun in his day. So secondary, this begs the question as to why Jesus had told his disciples to sell their cloak to get a sword. It's pretty strong. The reason Jesus told them this is because they would be sent out as missionaries, would have to travel all kinds of back roads with robbers, thieves, and murderers that were used for criminal activity. And Jesus is not telling us to overlook an offense to the point of committing, you know, I guess, suicide or ethical or legal omission of preserving our own lives or the lives of others. But he's telling us to turn the other cheek when it's possible. While that is an intense example, I appreciate you hearing me out regarding that. I was hesitant to tell that story. Third story of my life, when I used to live in Washington, D.C., I used to sell IT. That's technical support, software, hardware, all kinds of solutions to the federal government. Some of my accounts included like Congress, also FEMA, NASA, NAVC, NAVAIR, and NAVSUB. Those are my three of my favorite. That stands for Naval Supply Systems Command. They're different areas of, right, the sea, the air, and their submarines, and which is I was selling directly right next to the Pentagon, to the Naval's, the Navy's central hub, just minutes again from the Pentagon. And it's pretty cool. I really is one of my favorite clients. They were always very kind, very professional, very, very efficient. Love selling to the military. It was really my favorite account because my father as well was an electrical engineer with the Department of the Navy, and he often worked on aircraft carriers. Sometimes he flew around the country to different naval bases, and that was just one of the pictures I had of my father growing up. So one day while I was walking in Crystal City, on my way to a sales call or meet with a client over a specific solution, technology solution, I ran into a friend who was new to our Bible study, and I was happy to see her, and I called her lady or young lady, and shockingly, she slapped me right across the face, and she sternly insisted that I call her woman instead of lady. So I smiled, rather, taken back, and I responded lovingly because I knew that she was new to the Bible study. I knew where she was coming from, and I knew she was fairly new to the Christian faith, and I could have reacted much differently, by the way. And by God's grace, I spoke kindly to her and to the fact that she is a lady, which is a very high, classy comment and compliment. But that also I understand her feelings, and from a feminist perspective, sometime later, she came back to me, and she apologized, by the way, telling me that she was wrong and that she appreciated my not getting angry with her. And I smiled. And I just saw, you know, listen, what Jesus called the new way, right? That's all I could think of, playing out exactly as Jesus said it would. And I had the privilege and honor to be used by God, as stated in Matthew 5, to actually respond properly. Thank God, by God's grace. So while I could have argued with her about the legal meaning of the word lady or woman, I chose to follow the biblical approach provided by Jesus for ending a feud and overlooking an offense. Listen, being slapped in the face for paying her a compliment, you know, that might have been taken as an offense at first, but I endured, and no offense taken, I guess, in the end. Certainly not by me, because I understood where she was coming from. But thank God Jesus provided another way to accomplish, a better way to accomplish justice, right? The Apostle Paul says in Romans 12, he says this, "Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." That's Romans 12, 17 to 21. And this leads us to the fourth and last case study, which we're going to pick up next week. Next week's episode, part two here. You don't want to miss that. Best way to do that, by the way, is just go ahead and subscribe. You do that, hit that little alert bell down there. It's going to say, hey, listen, you're subscribed. Here's the alert bell. This part two is coming up. You won't miss any others after that as well. But in closing, we as Christians ought to be characterized by humility and selflessness. This means that if possible, that we voluntarily go the extra mile to maintain the peace, if possible, when and if possible. And that when wronged, if possible, that it's better not to strike back or to demand payment or refuse to comply, right? This is not a limitless rule, Christians are consistently using other Christians. And in those cases, maybe we got to put a kibosh to that. See, Romans 12 tells us, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live in peace with all, or peaceably with all. Romans 12, 18, today's truth is that Jesus provides us a better way of solving personal conflicts when possible. So when we do this, it in turn generates an incredible reflection of God's grace, mercy, and love, generating a strong witness for Jesus Christ. And as a result, the world will want to hear more about Jesus, the love of Jesus, the truth of Jesus. So I hope you start trying to do this daily, starting when? Right now, today. If you do, promise you, God's going to glorify your efforts, going to glorify you. And at the end of the day, your life's going to be filled with much less conflict because you have given the conflict over to the Lord to sort out. I pray you'll do that starting today. In closing, if you're listening to the podcast, please give us 5 stars in iTunes. That'd be really helpful. Plus, if you're a YouTuber, you know what I'm about to say. Man, there's a couple things you could do. In both cases, share this with others. Tell your friends. As always, if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. And I promise I'll get back to you within a very reasonable amount of time. Make sure to check out our new blog, by the way. Del Potter is adding some great content weekly to that. You can do that at rftblog.com. That's Reason for Truth, rftblog.com. Make sure you hit the subscription button and that little bell down there. You know, that little thing that, man, I always say, a left Italian hook. Bam! Go ahead and knock that thing out of the park. That notification bell is going to let you know when the new episode comes in. It's a play. It's a complimentary to the subscription. And listen, I appreciate that. If you feel moved to support Reason for Truth, it takes a lot of time, and there's a lot of things that we do really that you don't see and we don't talk about really internationally as a ministry to other people's lives and to organizations that we don't talk about. But they're there, and if you could help us, that'd be greatly appreciated. Your generosity, I can tell you, goes a long way. We use our resources very judiciously. You can do that at reasonfortruth.org or reasonfortruth.bible. There's a little donate button on there. You can sign up and do that. We're level 1 compliancy, so you're safe. And it is a tax-deductible gift. So God's blessings to you. Appreciate you tuning in. Make sure you do one thing. Make sure that we overlook an offense when we can. I'm your host, Stephen Garofalo, and that's your Reason for Truth for the day.